So one of my favorite reasons to create editing videos using Lightroom Web is because I always end up hearing from subscribers who tell me that they never even knew about it and that they can't wait to give it a shot. Now, while I work on the Lightroom desktop team at Adobe and I use it constantly, I'm amazed at what the Lightroom Web team consistently accomplishes as they work to make it a powerhouse photo management and editing app that you can run right from within a web browser tab. And honestly, that's what boggles my mind even after using Lightroom Web for so long. So often, the things that we turn to our web browsers for are to either spend time by consuming endless streams of content or to spend money by buying things from online vendors. So, to know that you can manage your cloud library and apply robust edits from that very same web browser tab has completely redefined my relationship with it. And my hope is that by showing you this editing workflow, while also showing you some of the new features added to Lightroom Web, you'll also feel motivated to spend more time by being creative with your web browser. All right, let's dive in. All right, so here we go. This is my cloud library. All of my photos sync to the cloud using Lightroom Web. You can see we are in a Chrome browser tab. And again, this is something that's important. I use Safari and Chrome pretty often on my computer. And my own personal experience is that using Lightroom Web in Chrome is just better. I just find it to be a much better experience. So I want to share that with you. And to access Lightroom Web, you'll just go to lightroom.adobe.com and then log in with your Adobe ID. And then any photos that you have synced to the cloud will be here, as well as your folders and your albums. Now, before I go through an editing workflow, I just want to show you one of the cool things that the team is working on that is available. If you expand all photos and then click on cleanup over here, you'll see these two tabs, clutter and duplicates. And duplicates is what I want to focus on right now, because this is very cool. What Lightroom will do is it'll analyze your library and surface potential duplicates for you to consider. So in some cases, like here, if I click on this image and then I arrow over, you can see they are close. And by going to grid, I have the option to decide whether I want to keep both of them, or maybe I don't want one of them, in which case I can either delete it or I can apply a reject flag or go the opposite route and give it a pick flag and a star rating. But the point is that you'll want to just go through this and review them. And when you're done, what you can do is click on mark as reviewed, and then it'll be removed from the duplicates view. Now, in some situations, like for example, these two and these two, you can see one of them is a Sony RAW file and one of them is a DNG. And that's because they are pretty much the exact same photo, except this DNG had AI denoise applied. So while they are duplicates, so to speak, they're really not. They're two separate photos. Also, if you look on the thumbnail, there are these two icons. The left one indicates that this image has been edited, and the one on the right indicates that the image is in an album. Now, before we move on, there's one very important thing that I want to highlight, and that is this early access badge on the top right. This is really important. When you click on I here, you're going to be given some additional context about the Find Duplicates feature. And it's really important that you take some time to read this and really understand what it means. Again, this is a feature that is still being worked on. It could have bugs, it could not work the way you expect it, and the team might decide not to ever release this feature altogether as a commercial version. But what's super important, if this is something that excites you, if this is something that you'd like to see eventually be rolled out as general access, click on this leave feedback button. You can click it here, or you can click right here on this blue feedback button and share your experience using Find Duplicates. Like, I love it, so I'm gonna click on the smiley face here. Then you can click this drop down over here, and I'm gonna say, it helped me clean up my library. And then, of course, you can type in some additional feedback and then submit it. I cannot stress enough the importance of submitting feedback, not just with cleanup, but throughout Lightroom, you'll see features that are early access that are still being worked on. And by you submitting that feedback, it really helps the teams out. Like, they actively monitor it, and it's used to help make the features even better if and when it actually gets released to public. All right, now I'm going to walk you through an editing workflow. And the purpose of this, again, is to kind of, one, remind you about the things that you can do in Lightroom Web, but also it gives me an opportunity to show you some of the new features that were added in these recent updates. So you can see I've got this photo kind of underexposed of this man-made wooden bridge with this stream. And so the first thing that I used to do was I would just go to the edit panel here and I would click on auto. But with the most recent updates to Lightroom, including Lightroom Desktop and Lightroom Mobile, we have a new adaptive profile that's available for supported RAW and DNG files, and it's available in Lightroom Web as well. So to access it, the easiest way that I found is just to click on the profile dropdown, and you'll see there is adaptive color. So watch what happens when I click on it over here. You can see it does this really, really nice job of analyzing the contents of the photo and making changes to light and color. And in some cases, like, you can just be done with this. Like, if you're happy with this, this looks great. It's properly exposed, colors look good, has nice amount of contrast. It's just ready to share. But the most important thing that I want to point out is that because this is a profile, as opposed to using auto, which I'll show you in a second, none of the actual editing sliders were affected. So what do I mean by that? Well, let me use one of the other new additions to Lightroom Web. It's simple but powerful, and that is this undo button. So here I can undo, and we're back to the Adobe Color profile. Watch what happens when I click on auto. You can see how all of these sliders have been adjusted. And here's the thing. Auto is great. Like, I've used auto for years, and it does help me get a quick idea of what I can do with my image, but it does actually adjust the sliders, and that's just something I got used to. The reason why I really love the adaptive profiles are because they look at the contents of the photo. It's been trained using AI to deliver results that are kind of tailored for the specific photo. So, like, if there was a sky in the photo, the edit applied to the sky section of the image would be slightly different than, for example, if there was a subject in the foreground, and then also for the rest of the scene. And to me, when I use it, I definitely see an improvement. And the point is not necessarily to over-stylize your photo. It's not meant to give a look. What it's meant to do is to apply corrective edits to the photo that are adapted to the specific qualities of it. And so again, you can see auto applies these sliders, and I can click on undo over here. And then watch what happens. Let me apply adaptive color. We really, really recommend not to use adaptive color with auto, to the point where when you click on auto, you're going to get this dialogue that says, for best results, avoid using auto and Adobe Adaptive together. Of course, you can bypass it. You can not see this anymore. I'm going to take the suggestion and not apply it. And so you can see that the sliders are zero. And that's kind of the point, is that, like, I'm looking at this, and really, maybe with the exception of bringing out shadows a bit more, and maybe moving the black point up a bit, there's really not much that I want to do in terms of correcting the light and the color. Like, I'm being totally serious here. It looks great. And so now that I have kind of this base exposure, actually, the first thing that I do want to do is I want to go to crop here, because this area on the bottom left really isn't doing much for me. So I'm going to crop in here to right around there. Let's go back. That looks good. Actually, I'm going to bring the composition down a bit right around there. Yeah, that looks good. Now, this tree trunk is bothering me. It brings too much attention just because it's so dark. And so what I'm going to do is go to healing. And this is amazing, the fact that we have generative remove in Lightroom Web. So what I'm going to do is make sure that this use generative AI checkbox is selected. And I'm just going to make a selection around that branch. Let's go ahead and click on apply. I'm going to turn the overlay off just so we can see the result. And then we get three variations. So there's 1, 2, and 3. 3 looks good, so I'm going to stick with that. And so now we're ready to start stylizing the photo. So I'm going to go back to editing over here. First thing I'm going to do is apply one of my beloved S curves. You'll notice I never use contrast. It's just not my thing. I like to apply contrast using a point curve. So I'm just going to apply a bit of a boost in the highlights here. I'm going to deepen the shadows right around there. Let's go ahead and add a bit more in midtones. And then I don't know, I just love adding a little bit of gray in the darkest parts of the image. And you could do that by taking the black point up and moving it up like this. You can see as I bring it up how it eventually turns white in the darkest areas, which I don't want, obviously. But a little bit of gray adds a little bit of that vintage look. Now, when I applied this S-curve, it did add a bit of a color saturation boost, which is nice in small doses Fortunately, we have this refined saturation slider, so I'm going to bring this down. Let's see. Let's go to zero and just maybe around 20. Yeah, 20. That's good. Right there. Now, we could have applied a custom white balance. Like if I click on the white balance dropper here and click somewhere here that's neutral, you can see the reason why I didn't is because it made the image look a bit too warm when I was practicing with it. And I didn't really like it. So I'm going to go back and use undo, which again is really nice to have. Let's go ahead and add a little bit of a global vibrance boost. I'm not going to touch saturation here, but one of the things that's bothering me now, actually, let me park the white balance dropper. What's bothering me is that the white caps in the stream are really, really hot. Like they're really bright. Now, normally if my software that I use to record these videos supported HDR, I would turn HDR on because here, this looks awesome. You can't see it, unfortunately, but now I have this really nice definition to these white caps. However, because I can't share it with you in the screen recording, I'm not going to edit there. And so I'll walk you through what I'm going to do. But before I do, you'll see there is this blue update button. Because we applied the adaptive color profile and then I used the generative remove brush, it changed kind of the order of operations. And so we're required to update that. So all you need to do is click on this update button. And that basically made this area here blend correctly. But I was saying that these highlights are a bit too hot. So I'm going to show you how I'm going to fix that. I'm going to go to masking over here. And I'm going to start by using a linear gradient. Now, one thing I want you to point out, we have pretty much feature parity in Lightroom Web with Lightroom Desktop and Lightroom Classic in terms of masking tools, which is absolutely amazing. Like we've got the object selection, we've got our adaptive masks up here, but I'm going to start with a linear gradient and I'm just going to draw up like this. Now, if this mask, the color of it is too strong, what you can do is click over here. I have it at almost full opacity, but I'm going to bring it down just so it's easier to see what we're actually selecting. So I'm going to close this. Now, I don't want the entire area to be selected in the mask. I just want the brightest parts. And so in this situation, what I'm going to do is I'm going to use a feature called intersect, except intersect is not in the Lightroom Web yet, but that doesn't mean that you can't do it. So let me show you what I mean. Intersecting is basically making a selection within a selection. So my first selection is this linear gradient you can see right here. But within this linear gradient, I want to select just the brightest parts of the image. If we were using Lightroom Desktop or Lightroom Classic, we would use intersect. But what we're going to do here is a combination of subtract and invert. So I'm going to click on subtract, and now I need to use another masking tool to make my selection within the selection. And I'm going to use a luminance range, and I'm just going to click on this bright area here. And so to make sure that only that is what's in the selection, now I need to do an inverse. So I'm going to click right here and watch when I go to highlight, you see how only the brightest areas are being affected within that linear gradient. So I'm going to go ahead and drop the highlights down a bit, somewhere right around here. I'm also going to drop the saturation of those highlights because they looked like they were a bit too cool. So somewhere right around there. And so the last thing that I recommend doing is just naming your masks. So I'm going to rename this and I'm going to call this white cap highlight adjust, just so that I know that that's what that mask is for. And then I'm going to go ahead and create a new mask. This time I'm going to select color range and I want to adjust kind of the verdancy, the greens in the image. Now I'm okay with this being global because I want it to be pretty much everything in the top part of the image. So let's go ahead and open up the exposure just a bit, make it a bit brighter. Go ahead and add a little bit of saturation. And I'm going to warm it up a bit. Let's go ahead and name this mask. I'll call this Green Booster, just because I'm so creative with my mask names. And let's go to the global editing panel again. All right, so the next thing that I want to do is I want to bring the eye further up. Like I like this foreground area here, but it's not really doing much for me. And so the easiest way that I know to do that is to use a lens blur, which is also available in Lightroom Web. Right down here, you'll see there's lens blur. So I'm going to go ahead and select apply. And I'm going to make this really strong initially just to see where the effect is being applied. Now you can control where that blur is applied based on this focus range tool over here. Now, if I move this to the left, it's going to blur everything in the background, but it'll keep the foreground sharp, which is what I don't want. I want the opposite. And so I'm going to start by moving this all the way to the right. And so you could see now the opposite is happening, where the background is sharp, but the foreground is out of focus. Now what I'll do is I'm going to start by dropping this amount slider significantly. You don't want a strong blur. Like, that just doesn't look realistic. But I do think that kind of a very subtle blur works. And so what I'm going to do is I'm going to start bringing focus back in by expanding this focus range tool. So maybe somewhere right around there looks good. You can see how it's very subtle, but it draws the viewer's eye further because this is the sharpest area. Now I can scroll up here as well, maybe add a little bit of texture to the image globally. That's fine. I'm not going to add any clarity to this photo, but I will add a little bit of a dehaze to add some more contrast. Now let's go ahead and expand the vignette tool here. I'm going to add just a bit of a vignette to further draw the eye towards the center. And now that I'm looking at it, this top part of the image is getting really punchy. Like, the shadows are getting really, really deep. So let's go to the masking tools here. I'm going to go ahead and create a new mask, another linear gradient, and I'm going to drag down right around here. And then I'm going to open up the shadows something like that. Looks good. Cool. Oh, and I forgot to rename that. So let me go ahead and rename this top half shadow booster. Cool. All right. Yeah, that's looking more balanced. And actually now what I can do is make a little bit of a stronger vignette. And so the eye, for me at least, the eye really goes up here quickly and then starts following this path. And then lastly, I'll go ahead and add a bit of sharpening. A bit more than what's there. And I want to remove it from areas where it's not needed. Now on desktop, I would usually press the Option or Alt key while dragging on the slider to get a mask view. We don't have that in Lightroom Web, but I do usually find that around 70 to 80% on this slider gives you the results where sharpening is only being applied to the high contrast edges. And so now you can see if I click on this eye icon at the very top here, this was our original photo. And then this is what we were able to get using all sorts of really powerful tools that normally you'd expect to find in Lightroom Desktop or Lightroom Classic, but within a web browser tab. So I hope, you know, showing you all of these tools and ways to edit your photo from a web browser tab gives you kind of ideas and inspires you to redefine your relationship with your web browser. Like, spend less time consuming, more time creating, especially with all of these powerful tools that are available. And it's one of those things too, like, let's say you're traveling and you only brought your iPhone and maybe your iPad with you. You don't have your laptop, but you want to work in Lightroom on a larger display or with the tools that are available in Lightroom Web, but not in Lightroom Mobile. Well, as long as you could find a computer at, say, a library or a cafe, or even if you've got a friend and you borrow their computer for a minute, you just go to lightroom.adobe.com, log in with your Adobe ID, and you have all of your photos that are synced to the cloud, which I think is amazing. Now, of course, Lightroom Web is only one component of the cloud ecosystem. So if you want to learn everything about Lightroom Desktop, Mobile, and Web, then please do check out my course called Lightroom Everywhere. I'll leave a link to it in the description below. And I mentioned that there are also huge improvements to Lightroom Desktop and Lightroom Mobile. I've got those videos right here. And if you found this video helpful, a thumbs up is always appreciated. And please be sure to click on the subscribe button and the bell icon to get notified of all future videos. Thanks a lot, everyone.